Good evening. Welcome to Ahorey for this special time on this Good Friday of praise, prayer, and proclamation of the Word of God. I greet all who are listening, especially those from Ahorey, Clare, and Vinnycash Presbyterian churches, in the name of our King and Saviour, the Lord Jesus Christ. In Lamentations chapter 1 and verse 12, we hear moving words, the words of the sorrowful people of God, and ultimately the words of the one who came to bear their sorrows and their sins. Here is what we read. The Lord Jesus Christ says, "Is it nothing to you, all you who pass by? Look and see if there is any sorrow like my sorrow, which was brought upon me, which the Lord inflicted on the day of his fierce anger." Is it nothing to you, all you who pass by? Let's come and see. Let's come and see Christ on the way to Calvary. Let's come and see the love of this suffering King. And let's begin as we pray together. Heavenly Father, on this Good Friday, we approach you in the name of your Son, the Lord Jesus Christ, and we do so by his Holy Spirit. And we come and we thank you so much for him. We thank you so much that he took our sins and our sorrows. He made them his very own. He bore the burden to Calvary and suffered and died alone. There was no sorrow like his sorrow, the sorrow brought upon him, which the Lord inflicted on him on the day of his fierce anger. Father, thank you that our Lord Jesus bore your wrath, that we might know your love. Thank you that he suffered our curse, that we might enjoy his blessing. Father, as we meet in these moments, I'm so conscious that there is nothing more important than the death, the resurrection of the Lord Jesus. So, Father, please focus our minds and hearts. And may his cross never be a small thing in our eyes. Father, may Jesus, far from being nothing to us, be everything to us. May the Holy Spirit lead us to come and see his sorrow and therefore his love, the greatness of our sin, but above all, the overwhelming greatness of his love. We pray all of this in his matchless name and by his Holy Spirit. Amen. We have two readings from the Word of God. The first is found in the Old Testament in the book of Isaiah the prophet. Isaiah chapter 52, verse 13 through to verse 12 of chapter 53. Let us listen to the Word of God. "Behold, my servant shall act wisely. He shall be high and lifted up and shall be exalted. As many were astonished at you, his appearance was so marred beyond human semblance, and his form beyond that of the children of mankind. So shall he sprinkle many nations. Kings shall shut their mouths because of him. For that which has not been told them they shall see, and that which they have not heard they understand. Who has believed what he has heard from us? And to whom has the arm of the Lord been revealed? For he grew up before him like a young plant and like a root out of dry ground. He had no form or majesty that we should look at him, and no beauty that we should desire him. He was despised and rejected by men, a man of sorrows and acquainted with grief. And as one from whom men hide their faces, he was despised, and we esteemed him not. Surely he has borne our griefs and carried our sorrows, yet we esteemed him stricken, smitten by God and afflicted. But he was pierced for our transgressions. He was crushed for our iniquities. Upon him was the chastisement that brought us peace, and with his wounds we are healed. All we like sheep have gone astray. We have turned every one to his own way, and the Lord has laid on him the iniquity of us all. He was oppressed and he was afflicted, yet he opened not his mouth. Like a lamb that is led to the slaughter, and like a sheep that before its shearers is silent, so he opened not his mouth. By oppression and judgment he was taken away. And as for his generation, who considered that he was cut off out of the land of the living, stricken for the transgression of my people? And they made his grave with the wicked and with a rich man in his death, although he had done no violence, and there was no deceit in his mouth. Yet it was the will of the Lord to crush him. He has put him to grief. When his soul makes an offering for guilt, he shall see his offspring. He shall prolong his days. The will of the Lord shall prosper in his hand. Out of the anguish of his soul, he shall see and be satisfied. By his knowledge shall the righteous one, my servant, make many to be accounted righteous, and he shall bear their iniquities. Therefore I will divide him a portion with the many, and he shall divide the spoil with the strong, because he poured out his soul to death and was numbered with the transgressors. Yet he bore the sin of many and makes intercession for the transgressors. Amen. So reads the word of God in the Old Testament, and we turn now to the New Testament, to the passage which will be our special focus for our time this evening. And we turn together to the Gospel of Luke, the Gospel of Luke and the 22nd chapter, verses 54 through 62. Luke chapter 22, verses 54 through 62. Again, let us listen to the word of God. Then they seized him, that is Jesus, and led him away, bringing him into the high priest's house. Peter was following at a distance. And when they had kindled a fire in the middle of the courtyard and sat down together, Peter sat down among them. Then a servant girl, seeing him as he sat in the light and looking closely at him, said, "This man also was with him." But he denied it, saying, "Woman, I do not know him." And a little later, someone else saw him and said, "You also are one of them." Peter said, "Man, I am not." And after an interval of about an hour, still another insisted, saying, "Certainly, this man also was with him. for he too is a Galilean. But Peter said, Man, I do not know what you are talking about. And immediately, while he was still speaking, the cock crowed. And the Lord turned and looked at Peter. Peter remembered the saying of the Lord, how he had said to him, Before the cock crows today, you will deny me three times. And he went out and wept bitterly. Amen. So reads the word of God. Before we think further about this text together, let us pray. Our Father, we thank you for your holy word. We pray now that the Holy Spirit, who inspired these words, would be our teacher, and above all things, would lead us to see with the eyes of faith the Lord Jesus, the greatness of his overwhelming love for sinners, that we may be moved to close with him, to believe in him, to hold him fast. We pray this in Jesus' name and by his Spirit. Amen. Period dramas, it seems, are all the rage. And I'd have to confess that in a rather embarrassing kind of way, that kind of suits me. Perhaps over the last few years, you watched Poldark on TV, on the BBC. 40 years after the first televised rendition of the story, its plot was again played out on screen. It's all about a young man called Ross Poldark, who, upon returning from the American Civil War to his home in Cornwall, finds his father to be dead, his property to be derelict, and most painful of all, his lover to be on the brink of marrying his own cousin. He feels lost in life. His heart is broken, his dreams are shattered, and his future is bleak. But then after several twists and turns and several ups and downs, he ends up in the first season marrying a girl called Demelza. It's a very unlikely marriage. She was his kitchen maid, but she comes truly to win his heart, and he comes to tell her the difference she has made in his life. He says, I married you to satisfy an appetite, to save myself from being alone, because it was the right thing to do. I had few expectations. At best, you'd be a distraction, a bandage to ease a wound. But I was mistaken. You have redeemed me. I am your humble servant, and I love you. It's a touching story, a moving account, and it highlights something that is true of every one of us. Our hearts and our dreams are fragile. And as we live in the present and look to the future, we long for redemption. In this confusing and broken world, we long for hope and joy. And there are times in life when, like Ross Poldark, we really do feel lost. Here's the question. Can a romantic relationship really redeem us? Can a successful career truly redeem us? In short, can we trust the world's wisdom to show us the way to everlasting hope and joy? Well, the answer, in the light of God's word, not to mention the light of human experience, is no. In the Gospel of Luke, we are shown that we are, in fact, more lost than we ever feared. The sense of restlessness in our hearts is merely symptomatic of our deepest problem as human beings, which is this. Something not acknowledged by Ross Poldark in that quotation I read. By nature, we are far from God. By nature, we are far from God. He is the one who designed us to live in an intimate relationship with Him. But the reality is that by nature, we are far from Him. That is our deepest problem. Our bondage to sin, our alienation from God, this is what makes us truly lost in life. And the world's wisdom is totally unable to help us here. But the gospel, the good news of Luke in the New Testament, presents us to one who has come precisely to seek and save the lost. In these pages, the pages of this gospel, we meet a man who is uniquely able to deal with our deepest problem, a saviour who is mightily able to draw us back into the intimate relationship for which we have been designed. His name was and is, never shall be, the Lord Jesus Christ. He is the Son of God. And during his short ministry on earth, he revealed God's heart perfectly. He lit up the way to hope and joy. And he told us all there is to tell about life. One man who knew him especially well was Peter. The Lord Jesus had eaten with him, walked with him, talked with him. And Peter had come to see that this was no ordinary man. This was no ordinary carpenter. No, he had come to confess that he was the Christ of God, the one commissioned by God to seek and to save the lost. Now, by the time of the Passover meal, Peter knew something of the reality that by nature, he was indeed lost, in need of such a saviour. He knew something of the fragility and depravity of his heart. But he had not yet come to see this clearly. You can hear his proud self-confidence in Luke chapter 22 and verse 33. Lord, I am ready to go with you both to prison and to death. The Lord Jesus has just told him, however, that Satan's desire is to grind him to pieces. His only hope is that the Lord has prayed for him. The Lord says to him, I tell you, Peter, before the cock crows today, you will deny three times that you know me. And that, as we read a few moments ago, is exactly what happened. Now, there are many things that could be said about Peter's denial of the Lord Jesus. We could consider the steps by which he came to such a fall. We could focus narrowly on the issue of faithfulness under pressure. But this evening, I want us to think very briefly about the striking sentence at the beginning of verse 61. We read together these words, "The Lord turned and looked at Peter." The Lord turned and looked at Peter. Can you imagine the scene? The third denial has been spoken, the crowing of the cock has been heard, and now Peter's eyes meet the eyes of the Lord. The Lord turned and looked Peter. We're not told for how long their eyes met. The facial expressions of the two men are not described. But it was a significant look, significant enough for Luke, of course, to record it. And the way that J.C. Ryle, the Anglican 19th century bishop, puts it, is insightful and moving. He writes, "There was deep meaning in that look. It was a sermon which Peter never forgot." And the character of the Lord Jesus is shown so clearly in the Gospels that we can safely imagine what kind of look it was, as well as what kind of message it conveyed. I want to suggest to you this evening that the Gospel was impressed on Peter's heart that morning. For when his eyes met the Lord's, he saw the truth about himself, the truth about God, the truth about life. Let me briefly suggest to you two things that Peter saw when the Lord turned and looked at him. I'll frame them with respect to ourselves because we are very much involved here. My aim is that the Lord's look may affect our hearts as much as it affected Peter's. Two things. First, when our eyes meet the Lord's, we see the greatness of our sin. When our eyes meet the Lord's, we see the greatness of our sin. Peter was more sinful than he had ever dared to imagine. He had seen something of his sin before the Lord's look that morning, but in that moment, the sheer horror of it all struck home to his heart. In the Lord's eyes, he saw pain and sorrow. In his own heart, he felt the gravity of his offence, and the only thing he could do was go outside and weep bitterly. Do you know this by experience? Do you know something of this awareness of the horror and the gravity of our sin? We were not there personally that morning, but the Apostle Paul tells us in Galatians chapter 3 that when the gospel is preached, the Lord Jesus is clearly portrayed as crucified before our very eyes. The Holy Spirit presents him to us. And when the eyes of faith are opened, we see him as crucified for his. Our eyes meet his eyes, and in his eyes we see the greatness of our sin. For he was suffering for us. He was bleeding for us. He was dying for us. His hands were nailed, and his head was gashed, and his heart was broken because he was taking our place, suffering our curse, bearing our blame. Would you see this evening the true measure of your sinfulness? Would you see this evening what it really is in the sight of a holy God? Let me exhort you. Look into the eyes of the dying Lord Jesus. Look into the eyes of the expiring Son of God and see in those eyes the reality, the gravity of your lust, of your pride, of your covetousness. See there the ugliness, the deformity, the horror of your sin. The truth is, we are more sinful than we ever feared. More sinful than we ever feared. Never make light of sin. Look to Calvary. Look into the eyes of the Lord Jesus and see that sin is a greater problem than you ever dared to imagine. See that you are more sinful. I am more sinful than we ever feared. When our eyes meet the Lord's, we see the greatness of our sin. But that's not all we see. And I'm very happy to say that. The Lord's look indeed was and is a look of pain, but it was and is also a look of love. And that leads us to the second point. When our eyes meet the Lord's, yes, we see the greatness of our sin, but we see also the surpassing greatness of his love. When our eyes meet the Lord's, we see, yes, the greatness of our sin, but we see also the surpassing greatness of his love. J.C. Ryle's words get him moving. He writes, surrounded by bloodthirsty and insulting enemies, in the full prospect of horrible outrages, an unjust trial and a painful death, the Lord Jesus yet found time to think kindly of his poor erring disciple. Even then, he would have Peter know he did not forget him. It was a look preeminently of love. A look of love. The Lord Jesus was saying to Peter, you are a great sinner, but I am a great Savior, and I am going to the cross of Calvary to die there for you, in your place, bearing your blame, suffering the curse that you deserve to bear, so that you might be saved forever. Your sin, Peter, is indeed great, but my love for you is greater still. Again, this applies to us. Praise God, we can say so. For when our eyes meet the Lord's, we see the surpassing greatness of his love. We come to see with the Apostle Paul that he is the Son of God who loved us and gave himself for us. The Son of God who loved me and gave himself for me. Did he weep? Yes, he wept for me. Did he groan? Yes, he groaned for me. Did he die? Yes, he died for me. He bled and died for me that I might be saved forever. He died for sins once for all, the righteous for the unrighteous, that he might bring us to God. I am more sinful than I ever feared. But in the arms of Jesus, I am also at the very same time more loved, more forgiven, more accepted than I ever dreamed. When our eyes meet the Lord's, we see, yes, the greatness of our sin, but we see also, at the very same time, the surpassing greatness of his love. We began with Captain Ross Poldark. I want to close instead with Captain John Newton. Drawing on the imagery of our text, Newton, in one of his poems, imagines himself standing before the cross. I'll share with you firstly the original words, and then, after praying, I'll share with you a musical rendition of them by Bob Kauflin from Sovereign Grace. Here, friends, is an opportunity to meditate on Calvary. Here is the gospel. Beautifully expressed. In evil long I took delight, unawed by shame or fear, till a new object struck my sight and stopped my wild career. I saw one hanging on a tree, in agony and blood, who fixed his languid eyes on me. As by his cross I stood. Sure, never till my latest breath can I forget that look. It seemed to charge me with his death, though not a word he spoke. My conscience felt and owned the guilt and plunged me in despair. I saw my sins his blood had spilt and helped to nail him there. Alas, I knew not what I did, but now my tears are vain. Where shall my trembling soul be hid? For I the Lord have slain. A second look he gave, which said, I freely all forgive. This blood is for your ransom paid. I died that thou mayest live. Thus, while his death my sin displays in all its blackest hue, such is the mystery of grace. It seals my pardon too. With pleasing grief and a mournful joy, my spirit now is filled, that I should such a life destroy, yet live by him I killed. Amazing grace indeed. Shall we pray? Lord Jesus, thank you. Thank you so much for dying for your people. Thank you so much for dying for sinners. Thank you so much for dying for me. Lord Jesus, when our eyes by faith meet your eyes, when the gospel is preached, we see the greatness of our sin and the surpassing greatness of your love. Lord Jesus, may each one of us come, perhaps even for the very first time, to know in our hearts the reality of sin and the reality of love, to believe in our hearts that we are more sinful than we ever feared. And yet, in relationship with you, at one and the same time, we may be more loved than we ever dreamed. Lord Jesus, we confess our sin. We humble ourselves before your cross. We lament our great iniquity, our terrible transgressions, our pride, our lust, our covetousness, our offenses too many to number. We lay them before your feet. We thank you for dying for us. We thank you for suffering our hell that we might enjoy your heaven. We thank you for suffering the Father's wrath that we might enjoy the Father's love. Lord Jesus, thank you. With all our hearts, thank you. And may we ever keep our eyes fixed on yours and forever see the greatness of our sin and, hallelujah, the surpassing greatness of your love.